Welcome back, everybody, to Game 3 of Na'Vi U.S. versus Sneaky Nick's Assassins. We're getting this. No breaks, man. We just keep on going. I can't tell you the last time that I've been able to squeeze this many games in a short period of time with no breaks at all, man. I don't know. These two teams apparently just want to keep at it. Normally, it's like somebody needs a smoke. Like, we're doing CIS teams. Like, at least five players go AFK after a game because they all need to have a smoke. But these Americans, man, they just want to keep hitting it, which is fine by me. So let's go ahead and jump into a game three. Sneaky Nick's Assassins versus Na'Vi US. The draft is already underway. Welcome in my co-caster once again. The Haz is going to be joining me.
Well, Sneaky Nick's Assassins are not fooling around. You are absolutely right. They wanted this game to start as quickly as possible, and then they opened their draft with two heroes that they've just been dominant on lately. Over the last 2 weeks, TC is 5-0 as Viper. He's got 40 kills and 10 deaths in those five matches, and IX Mike is 5-0 on that Centaur War Runner as well. They've farmed well. They've fought well on these two heroes. This is a very scary opening to that draft for them. Na'Vi US, of course, no slouches either on their side. Fogged, we talked about what he has done on that Skywrath Mage in the last draft, and snaking has been downright scary on Death Prophet when I've seen him on that hero recently. I'm a little bit curious to see whether they'll have a rise on that hero because he's played mid for them in the last two games, but that's something that we'll see as the draft goes on.
Yeah, I think that I would agree with you that Snake King has had a lot of success when it comes to this current meta. I know Snake King gets a lot of flack for his carry, and I think that some of it is warranted. Sometimes he just makes the wrong decision when it comes to team fights, and that happens to every player. But it seems like sometimes it's a little bit more obvious when it comes to Snake King's play than others. But he is a really exceptionally good farmer when it comes to he's a really good farmer, first of all. But I think he actually is much, much stronger when it comes to more aggressive mid-game oriented, teamfight oriented heroes rather than the late-game heroes, because I think sometimes he pushes himself to try and be like still be active in team fights and will end up still sacrificing himself by kind of throwing his hero on the line, being that frontline initiator sometimes, or being the first into a battle when sometimes carries need to play a little bit more passive. But I think you're 100% right. When you get a good aggressive hero, Snake King really does shine as that one position. I think Death Prophet fits his repertoire perfectly.
Yeah, I mean, to me, when people talk about carries and criticize the way carries do or don't play, I think that a lot of it has to do with the team's play style. I mean, Na'Vi US is not a team that likes to sit on their laurels and farm. This is a team that likes to be forcing the action across the map all the time. And, I mean, you can criticize Snaking as an individual for joining fights a little bit too often with his carries, or you can say, well, that's just the way the team plays, and you just try to pick the heroes, try to pick the kind of lineups that's going to maximize the effectiveness of that playstyle. And I definitely agree with you, though, at the end of the day, regardless of which theory you buy into, that a hero like Death Prophet is just ideal for him. And you've seen earlier today, by the way, the power of a farmed Death Prophet. This is not necessarily a hero that people think of as being in the farming position. Well, go watch Arteezy's games on Death Prophet earlier today in the WEC, him getting that shivas up, that heart up super early, and how scary that hero can be. Just able to just destroy entire lanes by herself.
10 seconds. Remaining. Yeah, I think one of the biggest thing that is so good about the Death Prophet for Snake King is that it's a hero that can take some abuse, and it's not necessarily so glass cannon style that if you get hit by the wrong stun or the wrong disable, that you're just going to end up falling immediately in a team fight. Death Prophet can certainly take a lot of abuse before she finally falls, and because of that, because of how tanky she is usually built, she is able to oftentimes survive through those nukes and be able to get off a little bit of return action, such as being able to, you know, use the Yule Scepters to save yourself or silence that right person or what have you. And I think that's part of the reason that Snake King does so well on the Death Prophet. And he's a really good farmer as well. So you're able to get up those fast items in order to make your Death Prophet so much tankier. We're now going to have the Wraith King and the Clockwork picked up by Na'Vi US in the second round to follow their DP and Skywrath Mage opening. And the Marana is going to be the third pick for Sneaky Nick's Assassins. Another hero that has had a pretty big success rate. I think Gorgon has really been one of the guys I've been co-casting with him a lot since we kind of given him this whole MSI beat it. I didn't really want to cut him out too much. And He's been praising the Marauders, saying that that win rate for the Marauders has been exceptionally high.
Yeah, interestingly enough, that's kind of the thing, that as her pick rate has gone down, as most people will probably know that listen to me at all, for most of 6.81, Murano was the most picked hero, and it was like by almost 50% more than the next closest. Lately, her pick rate's been going down, but as her pick rate's gone down, her win rate has gone way up. Mm-hmm. Sneaky Nyx Assassins overall in this draft, going for kind of up until now, a carbon copy of what they had done the last game with the Viper in place of the Razor, as we discussed at the very beginning. Now they go for the Shadow Demon, so definitely turning more into kind of a laning oriented draft, which on the Dire side I just love. I think they're going to build, this is something that I've seen them do a number of times, they're going to build a very strong aggressive tri lane around Ix, Mike, Centaur, Warrunner, and Degenerate played that here in the last game, so you might see that switch up, but boy oh boy, they are very, very hard to do when they do this. I think this kind of a draft, two strong soul laners and an aggressive tri lane out of the Dire side is just so very, very hard to beat in this current meta.
So the Shadow Demon Marauder combination for Sneaky Nyx Assassins, giving them some easy arrows to be able to land. I'm guessing this is going to be a Marauder support in this case. So you're going to be seeing probably another strong solo laner being picked up for the one position. Who knows? They may run another one position centaur, but I kind of doubt it. It makes sense with the Razor, who does have a little bit more mid to late game viability, but the Viper is definitely a mid hero that, while he may be able to establish a lot of early dominance, he certainly does fall off going into the 35 to 45 minute mark rather drastically. So for me, I don't feel a centaur one position. I feel like you would have a little bit too one dimensional of a draft. So I'm going to assume this is going to be an offlane centaur in the hands of Ix Mike, and we're going to be seeing a another strong, like, mid-game oriented carry, but one that maybe has a little bit more, late game viability to it. As the Brewmaster is going to be the pickup now for Navi US.
Interesting to me, Batrider not touched.
Luna.
Oh wow! Okay.
All right. I mean, that is one of the snowball heroes that have been kind of a hot topic for me and in many of my casts. I've been asking pretty much all my co-casters. Yes.
Okay.
Well,
you aggro trialing the Luna Marauder and Shadow Demon and soloing the Centaur, or the other way around?
Navi US. What is their trialing? They're going to be running the 1437 Wraith King paired up with the Skywrath Mage, Fog Skywrath Mage, and that puts them at a one position Brewmaster. That is a very, very tanky combination to get through. I'm not sure if I would feel comfortable running an aggro try. I think it would be too risky.
They are going to safe lane it. Yeah, I think that's probably right. I mean, the only misgiving I have about that is that, of course, when you go try versus try in both safe lanes, when you go a Dire safe lane try and a Radiant safe lane try lane, the Radiant safe lane try lane is generally going to have the advantage just because of the jungle setup, but it looks like we're going to have try v try top lane here, and if that's the case, this will prove to be a brilliant, I think, position by Sneaky Nyx Assassins to position the Shadow Demon and the Marauder on the top lane here. This clockwork in a try lane is not something that you see. Maybe what we're seeing is more a roaming support setup here, but I'm a little bit interested to see how this Wraith King and the Skywrath Mage are going to get anything done here.
Yeah, the clockwork. I mean, going for an aggro try with the clockwork, I'm not a fan of. I am a fan of sitting in the side lane and doing the secret shop, you know, two heroes in the secret shop waiting, going for that first blood, and then roaming from there. I'm a big fan of that, 100%. And that's what I would usually see with a clockwork. Here, I'm guessing 1437 and Fogged are just going to be doing a lot of roaming, because I honestly don't see how a tri-lane with clockwork is going to work to their favor at all.
Well, they have to roam anyway, because remember, it's the same thing that we talked about in the last game. Generally, and this is part of why you see people pick so many of these Razors and Vipers, because it really, when you leave any hero, Death Prophet can do okay against a Viper, but most heroes, when you leave them 1v1 against a Razor and the Viper, it places so much pressure on those supports to rotate early. And you're seeing just that happen here as the early smoke comes out from 1437 and Fogged.
They waited a very long time to be able to pull off this smoke.
Close.
But if it actually works, it's well worth it. In fact, it will. They get out the stun. TC has no chance to be able to survive through this. They follow up with a slow from Fog and an easy first blood going the way of Snaking. So in the end, now the U.S. waiting for basically a full minute there, not showing up anywhere on the map by having this positioning and just laying on it. Actually ends up working out very well for them.
So interesting move by TC here. I actually thought he had just hit level 2 when they came in for the gank, and I actually thought that he might put a point in Corrosive Skin and try to live. At the end of the day, I think he's much better off doing what he just did. He saved that skill point, died, put it into Nether Toxin for lane dominance, and you can already see the Death Prophet is now at like 1/3 HP from the harass.
Snaking, yeah, he's going to need that bottle real quick. Bottle as well as Boots are both going to be coming his way. They can actually ensure the next rune. He's going to be right back up to full fluff and stuff. Is currently sitting with the arrow.
Oh,
he's going to miss
goodness.
That one, though.
I thought he had that.
That needs to be a little bit better coordinated between the two of them. The TC had managed to like start running forward and gotten a slow. At the very least, Snaking would have had to sacrifice dodging the arrow in exchange for extra hits from the Viper and copying that slow as well. Now, Snaking is just sitting a little bit too far forward, has to dodge another arrow, but TC may go for the dive here. As one more hit, not quite enough, and TC not going to be able to go for it anymore.
But that also assures the rune. Right,
that's
that true. Also protects the regen rune up top, which, did you see which side pinged that rune out? I missed that.
I didn't, but either way, it's going to be...
I guess it's got to be SNA, because they're the one that have the... No, both teams have the rune one.
Yeah, both teams have vision, so they'll both see that TC is going to be right back up to full after copping a Crypt Swarm to the face, and now Snaking is maybe going to need another gank. He's certainly going to need an upgraded courier as soon as it's 3 minutes, because he needs to bottle crow pretty well here in order to get back into this lane, despite the fact
Radiant's
he was able to establish his dominance with that first blood.
Boy, and Sneaky Nyx Assassin is doing what I think any dire side tri-lane should try to do, especially in this kind of a situation, and that's put pressure on this tower really early, especially behind that Lunar Blessing, giving all three heroes there that big damage bonus.
Yeah, unfortunately for them, they weren't able. Brax was able to get just close enough where he could throw out the rocket and actually pull the creeps off of the tower. It requires you to be a certain distance close enough for the creeps to be able to recognize the fact that you were the one who shot the rocket and try and aggro onto you. And the important thing is about supports trying to push him out of that range and effectively limit the power of that rocket spam. But they weren't able to do it, and because of that, the Tier 1 tower was actually able to take very, very little damage and actually return fire onto the Luna a couple of times.
Yeah, I didn't actually. I was looking at this in response to a comment from Misery about Midnight Pulse earlier this morning. Clockwork actually does an insane amount of hero damage per match with Rocket Flare. I did not realize this. I kind of always been a little bit dubious about the max rocket build, but Korok had used that very, very well in a game about a week ago that I cast,
Dio's
and you can see Brax is going to go that build in this game as well.
Yeah, I've actually had I have had some players actually tell me that they really don't like the maxed out rocket build either. But you're right, it can be super effective. It's just that the problem is that once you hit level 6, level 7, you don't have nearly the same kill potential solo as a Clockwork. But that just requires a different style of play, really.
Exactly. And that's kind of the thing, that when you're in this situation, it looks like, set
Bugs
up down here.
Is done rip. For. Arrow's going to be able to land on him. They'll just right-click him down. No need for using any extra mana. So good rotation there from the Rana and the Shatter Demon. First one, 5 minutes in. Now TC is going to get turned around a little bit, but they don't actually have enough mana for Snaking, as he already used his last Crypt Swarm. 1437 is actually going in for a deeper dive here. Phasewood's going to be picked up by Snaking, as well as a bottle, which will ensure the kill. 1437 is going
to
survive.
I think you have to get a level in the passive. This is why I do... I liked TC's skill decision at the very beginning. I don't like the 3-2-0 build on Viper. I think you get one level in that passive, and it just gives you a little better chance to survive a dive like that.
Yeah, now there's really no punishment for the fact Snaking has been spamming out Crypt Swarms as well. Snaking is going to fall as the Shatter Demon and the Mirana come in, and TC will be able to ensure that last hit pretty easily. So another good rotation by them. But yeah, I agree with you, because the Crypt Swarms, man, there's no punishment for the Death Rabbit whatsoever.
Right.
And as you said, it gives you that option to be able to just survive through those nukes a little bit longer.
And a lot of people, it's funny, Dire's a lot of people will underestimate the just sheer amount of damage that Viper can output passively in a 2-2-1 build. If he tries to, if Viper obviously very slow, but if squishy supports try to gank him early game, he can easily turn that into a double kill with that kind of a build.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, think about it at level 2. When you are, level 3 rather, when you have, more often or not, you're going to start spamming some Crypt Swarm. Maybe not at that's a level 1 Crypt Swarm, but definitely at level 2 when you pick up your level 3 and 4. Mm-hmm. And basically, you're doing 175 damage, magic damage going out, but that's going to be mitigated by the extra resistance that a Viper has, even just at level 1, and you're also returning 40 damage back.
Right.
To the Death Prophet with just that one Crypt Swarm hit. And every single following physical damage attack that she tries to put in as well is going to be another 40 damage resulting pack. I mean, do you even want to try and trade hit for hit against a Viper when you're taking that much extra damage from basically you hitting him?
Right, and I mean, you saw how hard Snaking had to bottle Crow here in the early game and was all but forced out of lane just because of that passive harass from the Viper, and that corrosive skin just makes it that much more difficult on you.
Yeah, so I kind of feel like the Nether Toxin was, that, especially that extra level. If it was a 3-1-1 build, I'd be okay with it, but that extra level is, I feel, a bit
Clockwork! Oh my, beautiful hook from Brax's Clockwork on the top lane. Gonna get a kill on the Luna here, it looks like.
Yep, should be able to. The last nuke comes in, finishes him off. Meanwhile, back in the mid lane, we have Snake King, who was being doped by the Centaur ultimate as well. Snake King should be low enough for him to be able to finish him off. TC, oh, the poison. There it goes. Poison or the Shadow Poison. Either one was going to be able to finish him off. 1-4-3-7. Not going to be here in time to be able to stop that one. TC just teleports himself away just in time. So a 3-for-3 trade off as Clockwork was able to get that Luna, but lost Snake King's Death Prophet in the mid lane.
Yeah, and that's definitely definitely getting a little bit concerning here. Snaking at 2-2. I guess he's only one level behind, and he is making decent progress for that drum, but this Viper is going to have his mech up here before too long, and that starts to get pretty scary, despite the fact that Luna is not farming very well.
Another exorcism getting used by Snake King as he approaches the mid lane, wants to finish off this tier 1 tower as soon as possible. They also have the Blink Dagger up for Arise. He's going to go back to base and pick up a smoke as well and finish that one off. Ike's Mike is actually going to teleport in here. Arrow's going to sneak and right past both of the Na'Vi members. They'll turn around, get a little bit of damage here and there, but nothing else is really going to come out of this. The big rotation is going to be from the Brewmaster. He's going to smoke up with Fogged and reveal his new Blink by jumping on Luna, and this should be an easy kill. No requirement of using the ultimate. Brax copped a couple of those bounces that he didn't really want, but he still survives, and the Brewmaster ultimate keeps his ult intact for the time being.
Yeah, I'm a little bit surprised that Luna used Eclipse there. I mean, it was close, and perhaps with a Lucent Beam off, that's a kill on the Clockwork there, but still, that's kind of a costly cooldown to blow at this point, especially when you're being chain ganked top.
Demon is going to lose his reincarnation, but they shouldn't be able to kill him here a secondary time, especially since the teleports.
Speaking of costly cooldowns.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, just being able to pick off the Wraith King is almost as good as a kill early on, this early on at level 1.
I agree. No, in fact, I would almost rather have that reincarnation down than a kill on him before he skills that reincarnation, just because you're not worried now about that slow in the team fight for another 5 minutes.
Right, exactly. And that's why, like, Zai will hold on to his reincarnation just for that exact thing, is that, you know, sometimes when you get ganked very early on as a support, and you have no one else around, it's better just to die than actually lose the reincarnation, save that for an actual fight. Especially if you're just going to die a second time. Looks like they will be able to jump Ix Mike because he tried to move a little far forward, but he will get himself out thanks to that Centaur ultimate and the distance.
Nice deny the rune by Snaking. I got to give Snaking a lot of credit, by the way, in this game, that he has gone blow for blow with that Viper in the middle. And you see there at CS parity, and sure, he's gotten some ganks, but that's a compliment to Snaking as a player, and it says how much that Na'Vi US's supports have gotten done with their rotations. That should not, Viper and Death Prophet should not be at CS parity at 10 minutes.
Yeah, Viper should definitely be a little bit farther ahead than the Death Prophet, if not a lot harder, depending on what your skill build is and how you play the lane. Bottom lane looks like they are going to be trying to push in a little bit. They do have the Brewmaster ultimate still available to them, so if there is any real defense, centered here by Sneaky Nyx Assassins. They'll immediately jump it, and that's why Way Too Sexy in some trouble. Already, he has to disrupt himself. The stun's going to go out. They will easily be able to kill him, but we have Ike's Mike, who's going to be silenced up. Arise doesn't have the mana right now for an ultimate or a slow, and he may just abandon 1437 to his fate. As he's going to get stunned up, TC should be able to get close enough, teleport away. He's actually going to get out. 1437 is fine, and Arise will also get himself away. So they may not have gotten the tower, but they got a free kill and forced some rotation.
Yeah, at the end of the day, I think that that's probably, you probably don't mind that, right? As Way to giving up your life in exchange for a tower, that's not such a bad thing. And forcing their cores to spend some time, or at least the Brewmaster to spend some time there chasing you down and then TPing out. At the end of the day, this is definitely going to be closer.
Go, Brax, no. Man up. He's got a blade mail. Yep.
Goodbye.
Luna did not see that one coming, and he unfortunately does not have a teleport, so he's going to die here to Way Too Sexy. But that's fine. He got a kill on the Luna. That is huge.
Fluff. Just unnecessary there, my man. With a little bit of an angry arrow right in there. TC's Viper could have had that kill anyway. But I suppose that's all right. You know what? You gotta make him pay for ganking your Luna.
Yeah, I love that, by the way, the early blade mail build, the immediate blade mail, like no other items being picked up. Snake King, he's trying to get this middle tier 1 tower. The glyph goes out and looks like it will get denied by Ike Spike. But yeah, that build is so good against Lunas. So good. Clap is going to go down. There goes the Brewmaster Ultimate. He'll easily be able to get at least one kill here on Way Too Sexy. Gets the stun on TC. Brax falls up. And with the blade mail, easily being able to get a second kill from that good rotation from Arise. Another good setup with the Blink. And what is with Brewmasters doing this, by the way? What the hell?
For the heck of it.
I guess so. They got this poor range creep who's just thrown up in a tornado, tortured essentially,
like mean,
before he's
man.
Brought down to earth and killed. It's pretty disgusting.
He's still up there. Jeez, poor guy. This is, at the end of the day, this is a closer game. This was a closer game than either of the first two until right then. You just can see in the last couple of minutes how that gold graph has spiked up. And this is, I tell you, I am not one of the people that is crying for major balance changes. As Arise does eat an arrow, but it's not going to matter. I do want to see, though, a little bit done, not necessarily to individual heroes, but globally, to address the fact that I'm seeing more and more of these massive gold leads at the 10 and 15 minute marks. These games are fun. The laning phases, it does make the laning phase even more high stakes, but I'm routinely seeing now 5K gold leads at 15 minutes, and that's a product of a lot of changes. The passive gold change for one, the assist gold change for another, that's made those gold leads more common. Fogged here in a lot of trouble.
Sometimes supports pay when they try and take a risk and lay down some aggressive vision, and that is a perfect example of one of those times. They should be having a counter ward, and also a smoke is going to come out to Fluff and stuff, so he immediately counter it. That's the worst as a support too, because you're like, so at least sometimes when you do this sort of things, they don't actually see you ward. That one was very obvious that he was warding.
Brax just doing work in this game with another initiative.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, the disruption. Snake King should be able to finish him off, or maybe not. He went for the ultimate. Rather than try and go for the Crypt Storm, the result is Way Too Sexy will die instead. Snake King, though, is going to lose his life as the Luna comes in, pops the ultimate just to be able to ensure that Snake King does not survive. That was just Snake King, really, in the top lane, paired up with Brax. Meantime, though, they had Arise as well as 1437 pushing in the bottom lane. They did get a tier 1 tower off.
Yeah, and I think at this point that, you know, you're seeing this more and more, that the death ball meta has sort of evolved into the death blob, where you're seeing teams Dyer's at least try to force action on multiple fronts here, and I really like that. I mean, the Dota that we've seen over the past 2 days coming out at WEC has just been beautiful to watch, where you're seeing these fast-paced engagements in the mid-game occurring on multiple lanes, and I think that that's just, it makes the game a lot of fun. There's a lot of hate that goes around about the current meta. I actually really like it.
Arise is going to be in some serious trouble, if only they had been able to lead with that disruption. They wanted to wait a little bit longer, but the plan was to try and get a disruption and possibly go for the stun over the top. But unfortunately, the blink away by Arise was in time. And what is he getting, by the way? Is this? I think this is just a staff of Witchery. He's still going for the Aghanims. It's just odd that he went for the staff over the point booster.
Yeah, that is a little bit odd. He has had some manage, though, and once again, Prax, you're a monster.
Yeah, they didn't even have wards for this one. He actually was able to get himself through the cogs. Now Prax will die as he tried to frantically turn around and teleport away. Actually, he may not die, TC. One more hit. Can he actually get it? He's hiding right next to the trees, TC. Oh, he finally got it. He didn't realize. There's a ward right here. He's like, what the hell? I should have been. He shouldn't have seen me. How did he see me? He's even throwing a question mark on the map. That's because there's a ward there, dude. That's because there's a ward there. Bottom lane, they actually managed to catch out Way Too Sexy's Shadow Demon. But top lane, tier 2 should be falling from Snake.
Yeah, that's kind of the thing. And I mean, this is pretty much exactly what we saw in the last game. Just this sort of methodical choking off of the map. And this is even more pronounced. A 4-tower lead here already for Navi US. And this is just the kind of thing that it's so, so hard to come back from. I mean, to me, obviously an 8,000 gold lead at 17 minutes is obviously significant. But to me, the 4-tower advantage at this point is almost as significant by itself, because right now, you know, where can Sneaky Nyx Assassins go on the map to farm where it's safe? The fact that Prax has, you know, got killed there initiating on the Luna, to me, is less telling than the fact that he felt confident doing so in the middle of her jungle. Where is she supposed to farm right now in this game?
1-4-3-7. Unfortunately, this is going to be one of those times, or maybe not. We actually have a lot of teleports. He has a reincarnation. I was going to say he's going to die twice here, but his second life may actually be something here. They're going to throw a lot onto him, but the rest of the team is going to respond. He's already been taken down. Luna comes in with her ultimate, does a bit of damage to the Death Prophet. Prax, meanwhile, locking in 2 with the clap over the top, and he actually will be able to take out both of them as the Centaur couldn't do much against that. Moonlight Shadow goes off with TC. Oh, wow. Just barely able to teleport away as Prax was almost close enough to get that last battery assault tick onto the Viper. But 2 quick kills, and it turns out that 1437's reincarnation being up does make a difference. He actually delayed them long enough that they got quite the team fight in response.
Absolutely, and that's just that's probably a team fight there that they lose if they're a little bit less far ahead than they are. But at this point, you know, they can afford to take a fight 3v3, 4v4, 5v5, even without Exorcism up.
Prax is just going to make sure this tier 2 will go down without anybody getting too close. He throws down a defensive set of cogs. And Snake King will now use this set of exorcism to go to the mid tier 2, where we already have 1437 pushing out that lane, which is a very smart play. They're going to be able to ensure basically that bottom tower goes down guaranteed, and they get the bounty for it, while also being able to get a lot of damage on the tier 2 in the mid lane. Don't think they'll be able to finish it up, though.
Yeah, but this is still getting into that territory.
They needed to back themselves up. Arrow actually snags Snake King in the background. Meanwhile, Viper was able to tank a lot of damage from the Skywrath Mage Ultimate. He's getting low. Good. Silence goes off, catching out 3 as Fog continues to lay in that nuke damage against TC, but it's still not enough. The rest of Sneaky Nyx Assassin back themselves up, and now an overextension from 1437 doesn't get punished as the disruption into the arrow does miss. And finally, the tier 2 does fall. Really thought Sneaky Nyx Assassins could have taken a fight there with the exorcism going down, but I suppose without the Luna, not much is really possible. Degenerate is still trying to work towards his BKB, and is a good 800 gold away from him.
So this is where I am. I want to talk about something here that I'm a little bit ambivalent here about the Hand of Midas on 1437's Wraith King, because the benefit, of course, with this Midas is that he's not level 11, so he's got that much shorter cooldown on reincarnation. At the same time, you ask yourself, that Midas could have been a blade mail. Or that Midas could have been a Blink Dagger.
Right.
And those two items on that hero, I mean, I think that's part of what makes the 4-position Wraith King just so insanely good right now.
Yeah, and honestly, like, if the experience is nice from the Midas, but what happens if the Blink Dagger is what ensures you even just one extra big kill? That same amount of experience that you're getting, if not more, than this really, really late game Midas. I mean, it does ensure you to be able to basically build into a semi-carry going into the late game, but as we've been going on, this whole entire theme of these casts have been the mid-game, the early to mid-game is so important right now. We're talking about snowballing. It used to be that we wouldn't look at an 8,000 gold lead by 15 minutes and call that significant, but because it's all coming from the map control, because all these towers are down, and because the meta is oriented, it's itself to basically being so snowball oriented that there isn't a whole lot of stall out. There's not a whole lot of time for teams to be able to find openings with smoke or sit back and farm or split push, because eventually these towers going down results in just a couple more minutes of farming, and you're going to see Na'Vi US five man down mid, and that's going to be your death push.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, like we said earlier, I don't dislike necessarily the changes that have led us here. I mean, I think that the idea behind a lot of this, the gold, passive gold increases and the assist gold, was to try to incentivize early support rotation. Oh, a nice initiation again from Brax.
And TC is going to be caught. Meanwhile, Brax is going to be trying to go on IX. Mike, Moonlight Shadow will save both of those heroes, though, as instead Na'Vi US will just try and push in the mid lane. They forced out a Centaur ultimate, and they didn't really lose anything too big in response. Brax's hookshot is down for another 38 seconds, but honestly, that's not too big of a deal.
Nah, and he's been really, really good with the hookshots in this game. I don't know that I've seen him miss one.
I think he did mix one. Remember when he dove the Luna with that blade nail for the first time?
Of course,
his hookshot was off cooldown, and I'm pretty sure he missed a hookshot. I didn't see it, though. So
I was trying to give you some love, Brax. You can blame Cap for this one.
Hey, listen, man, I'm a realist. Oh, Ryze! Three-man clap there. Now gets off the ultimate as well. Oh, good disruption nice save from Way Too Sexy. Meanwhile, the Luna ultimate goes off with the BKB intact. Sorry, Brax. Blade Mail doesn't do anything here. 1-4-3-7. Standing in the middle, does have his reincarnation. It's going to slow down everyone in the background. Unfortunately, the Brulinks aren't really doing that much. They've all been taken out, but the Exorcism is still doing a lot. There goes the Morana. Luna in the background is still fine. And up IX Mike reinitiating now with his secondary life. Couple of nukes are going to pursue him. He's actually going to fall as he teleported into total death there. Snake King now with a triple kill is going to silence up the rest. I think they need to back themselves up. They can probably go for the range racks at most during this downside of the Viper. Doesn't look like we're going to be having any more buybacks from the side of Sneaky Nyx Assassins.
Well, there's Mystic Shot number two, and I Cap, I have four words for you that pretty much define the game. Fog has a Dagon. I think that's all you need to know about how this game is going.
Yeah. Now, it looks like they got themselves out in time. I was going to say, make sure they don't overextend themselves. I just wanted to see them go for the range racks and back themselves up. And sure enough, they will get out in the right time. As Sneaky Nyx Assassins were more than willing to take a fight, even if it was 4v5, because all the big ultimates from Na'Vi US were down.
Yeah, and this is just, I mean, the items now coming out for Na'Vi US are just terrifying. You see a 23-minute heart up on your Death Prophet. You see a Blink and Aghanim's already completed on the Brewmaster with 1,200 gold to spare. You know, the Armlet Midas on the SK and the aforementioned Dagon on Fog Skywrath Mage. This is, yeah, not looking good here for Sneaky Nyx Assassins in Game 3.
Fluff and Stuff will be able to get himself out, but he was forced to use a Moonlight Shadow there. As Degenerate feels a lot more comfortable sitting forward and farming. 1437 is going to be sneaky around the back door, and Brax missed another hook. He's going to be chasing Degenerate a little bit. He's hoping for... Okay, instead we have the Luna just go ahead, pop the BKB and teleport out. As 1437 was wrapped around. I was going to say, a Blink Dagger on the Wraith King could mean you could blink on that Luna and get the almost instant stun. And maybe catch Luna by surprise before she could BKB. Professional players, unlikely, but you never know.
Yeah, interesting use of Stampede there, but that's okay. You're kind of in desperation mode at this point. Yeah, of course, since I called Brax out, since I talked about Brax, he's going to hate me now.
Yeah, he's missing hook shots left
totally
and right. And that's
missed, like, three straight.
Yeah, that's not on him anymore. That's on you, dude. You jinxed him. Snake King going to be gone on, stomped up. Degenerate turns around. He still has the Eclipse, but they're not going to go for it just yet. There's too many creeps in the way for the time being. Silence, TC on the front line. He's going to be sharing damage with IX Mike. Meanwhile, good disruption. There goes Degenerate. Let him lose the ultimate. They're going to go for 1437 first, but still have the ultimate intact. Degenerate no longer having the BKB, still on cooldown. He's going to be taken out by that last nuke from Fog. TC, meanwhile, turns around, fights up against 1437. Almost being able to get the kill. Will get it with the Shadow Poison, but Brax will ensure the counter kill. Arise gets a kill on Way Too Sexy with the clap and double clap, kind of ensuring it there. And Viper TC with the only one with a buyback, but Na'Vi US fully in control of the enemy space, and it's going to be taking down a second set of racks.
Yeah, I expect a GG call here pretty shortly, and then Fog tweeted at me the other night after he came one kill short of breaking the record. He said, you know, I'm sorry, I didn't know, but that's okay. He's going to make up for it here with an Ultra Kill and a Dagon on Skywrath Mage. to finish off Sneaky Nick's Assassins. This has just been a dominant performance by Navi US here in games 1 and 3, and really thanks guys, love you.
Well done by Navi US. They get themselves into the grand finals for the MSI Beat It 2014 Global US qualifier, and we are now going to be jumping ourselves down into the losers bracket where we will follow Sneaky Nick's Assassins, and they will be facing up against Team Dream Destroyers, who made themselves, they got knocked out by Navi US in the first round and have made them their way through the losers bracket the whole entire way in order to get to the losers bracket final. So that is going to be our next best of three coming up in just a few minutes.